Welcome to the Pictures of Lily podcast. I'm your host, Lily Moayeri. I have been a music journalist since 1992, and I interview a lot of music-related people. This podcast, which is named after the song by The Who, is about my experience behind the story, what my experience is doing the interviews, just to give you a snapshot of what it's like on the other side of the digital recorder. Pictures of Lily. Thank you, everyone, for tuning into the Pictures of Lily podcast. This is episode 52, like the number of weeks in a year, like the number of cards in a standard deck. You can find us on every platform by going to picturesoflily.com, where you can subscribe or follow us and also connect to us on Instagram, SoundCloud, YouTube, Pandora, and Amazon. Although it's really best to listen to the podcast straight from the source at picturesoflily.com, as it is the best quality audio and avoids copyright restrictions. From Duran Duran to a band who wish they were Duran Duran and who excites me as much as only bands in your teenage years can, Mansun. Here are a few snapshots of my experiences with Mansun. Just to clarify, the band I'm referring to is the British foursome of the mid-90s, M-A-N-S-U-N, named after the Verve song A Man Called Sun, not Marilyn Manson. My first exposure to Mansun was in 1996 when they performed on the British variety show TFI Friday. I was at one of my good friends in Liverpool's house watching TFI Friday because that's what every single household in the UK would do in the mid to late 90s when Mansun came on. My friends said Mansun were managed by our other friends, and while we were watching the show and I was being blown away by the performance, our manager friends walked in with sticker passes from the taping still on their clothes. I was so into Mansun instantly that I kept one of their passes as a keepsake of the first time I heard them, and I still have it. My Liverpool friends told me Mansun were playing in Manchester the next night and they would take me if I wanted. I did want, and we did go, and it was one of the most intense gigs I have ever experienced. Partially because it was so jammed I could barely see the stage, partially because it was Manchester on a Saturday night, so that in itself is a scene, and partially because it was the first of many stops my friend and I were making around the north of England that evening, so I had to keep my energy in check. I didn't forget about Mansun, not even a little bit, and the following year I was back in England when they were releasing their debut album, Attack of the Grey Lantern. I wanted to do an interview as I was sure I could place it once the album was released stateside a few months later. Their managers, my friends, suggested I come to the warm-up gig for the tour at a venue called Moles in the historic town of Bath. I really didn't want to make a trip of it, but my London friends I was staying with, who were also instantly blown away by Mansun, said they would take me. I'd do my interview, we'd go to the gig, and we'd make an overnight trip of it. I agreed to that. To give an idea of the state of technology at that time, I didn't have a mobile phone in the US, but they were more prevalent in the UK. I was borrowing my London friend's phone for the duration of my trip. I was picked up by Mansun and their crew in a van and taken to a different hotel than the one I was staying in for the interview. The whole drive there, Chad, who is the guitar player for the band, was writing out the lyrics to all the songs in red ink. I asked him why he was doing that, and he said he was doing it for Paul Draper, the singer. This confused me because Paul writes the song, so how come Chad is writing out the words for him? I asked Chad about that, and he said it was because Paul tended to forget the words. I was still digesting this information when we arrived at the hotel. Everyone left the van, and before I could get out, they shut the doors and locked the whole thing down, and I couldn't get out. At the same time, my phone had died. I spent a huge amount of time sitting in that van trying to figure out how to get out because, strangely, it was as hard to get out of it as it was to break into it. After a while, I worried less about getting out and more about what I would say and what position I would be in when the band finally came back to the van to drive to the gig because it was getting to be that late. My friend who managed them finally came out, opened the van, picked me up, and carried me into the hotel like a child. and told the band, "I told you she would be in the van." The band had thought I had ditched them once we had arrived at the hotel, which was kind of insecure of them, but also understandable to a certain degree, as I was going to be their first U.S. interview, and at that point, I don't think they had done a lot of interviews yet. I sat with Paul and tried to ask him questions, but he spent the whole time picking apart a matchstick and not making eye contact with me. He finally said that I looked exactly like some Italian girl he went to school with called Marcelina that he could never talk to. This was weirdly a relief as it explained his weird behavior, but it was also annoying as I really needed some quotes for my interview. He did tell me that the only reason he learned to play guitar was so he could play his songs, that he didn't learn by playing other people's music ever, only his own. I do remember thinking that Paul's eyeliner was uneven. Not noticeable on stage, but in close proximity I could really see it as he was using liquid eyeliner, which I thought was a brave choice. To this day, I am still too afraid to use it as it is so hard to manage. We went to the gig and it was even more bonkers than the Manchester show, which I didn't think was possible. Their album had been released that day and gone straight to number one, so that might have had something to do with it. The next time I saw Mansun was in Los Angeles, and I ended up talking to Stove King, the bass player, after the gig for a while because my two girlfriends were very interested in having an interaction with him. The next night, he acted like he had never met me, which threw me off a lot. I saw Stove again in New York soon after that at a music conference. We were at a party, and he came up to me and was very friendly, and I just said, "Oh, you remember me now?" And he was very confused as he had no recollection of the second night in Los Angeles. My friend I was with had a nose ring, and he asked if he could stick his finger in her nose to see what the ring felt like on the inside. She said no, and I said why not, and I didn't think about it at the time, but I really bullied her into letting him stick his finger up her nose. Which he did, and when he took it out, he put it in his mouth and said, "You've been doing cocaine." Which mortified my friend, who admitted that she had been. Stove was telling me about a helicopter ride he had done around Manhattan last time he was in New York, and he said we should do it the next day and took the number of where I was staying. He called me the next day, pretty early, and I said I was surprised he was up, but he said he had never gone to bed and he was just waiting for time to pass so he could call me for us to go on the helicopter ride. I had a lunch appointment with Fran from Travis, so I told Stove I would meet him at his hotel after. Stove was concerned about time because Mansun were flying back to the UK that evening and needed to leave the hotel by mid-afternoon. I made it to their hotel and Stove and I took cabs to every heliport on the island of Manhattan, but the flights were either booked or the next flight wasn't until too late. I only had a $100 bill on me and every time we were getting out of a cab, I tried to pay the driver with it, but they don't take hundreds. Stove said it was a good way for me to get out of paying for cabs. I bought him a couple of drinks when we went back to the hotel to make up for it, and when Mansun were leaving for the airport, he made me promise we would go on the helicopter ride next time. I told him I lived in LA and that it was unlikely I would be in New York next time he was there. We never did go on our helicopter ride, but I went the following year with some other UK friends. That year, 1998, I went to the Reading Festival as a guest of Mansun. That's what it said on my ticket. I was so excited by my ticket that I wanted to keep it as a souvenir instead of trading it in for my wristband. By then, it had been 2 years since I saw them play on TFI Friday on TV, and they were thousands of times better, and they were already pretty damn awesome before. They were so amazing that I was starting to lose feeling in my legs from being overwhelmed by their performance, and I wanted to lie down on the field. Mansun had played so many gigs by then that they were not only flawless, but a very accomplished live band. I saw Stove after and told him that I'd finally done the helicopter ride around New York, and he said I was supposed to have waited until he came back. I believe that was the last time I saw Stove, but I have very fond memories of him and how fun and forthcoming he was during the time we spent together. I stayed a devoted Mansun fan, and when their final album, Kleptomania, was released due to fan pressure, I had the day marked in my calendar and went driving over to Amoeba to purchase it immediately. I didn't find it in the store and asked a clerk who went to look it up, and when I said it was released that day, he said they wouldn't get it for weeks. There was no way I could wait for weeks for a Mansun album, so I ordered it online from a web store in the UK. 10 years after that, I was connected with Paul through Facebook as a friend and also when he liked my page, which was a huge honor. He remembered the accidental locking of me in their van, which made us both laugh in retrospect. A friend of mine who runs a music management course in London was looking for some guest lecturers who were from the indie alternative scene, and I thought of Paul. I approached him about it, and he graciously agreed to speak. I don't know if that actually happened, but he was very nice about it. Paul has released a solo album and has another one in the works called Cult Leader Tactics. I'm sure he's not referring to himself, but the fact is he is a cult leader, as the cult of Mansun, of which I am a lifelong follower, is something very real and enduring. They made me feel like I was 15 when I was 27. I weirdly wanted to emulate them, especially if I saw one of them wearing a particularly identifiable piece of clothing in a performance video. I waited for their albums and sat in a room by myself for that crucial first listen. Their live shows made me feel transcendent. I still feel all those things about Mansun today. Those are a few of my Mansun experiences. All of my interviews with Mansun are in print magazines that live on my shelf, but unfortunately not at picturesoflily.com. At some point, they will make their way on there, but not in the near future. In the next episode, I will be talking about my 20 plus years of experiences with the one and only Reed Speed. From myself and my co-producer, director, editor, Lawrence Schroeder, thanks for listening. And if you have a chance to subscribe or follow the podcast on any of the podcast platforms, please do so and please rate and review. You can connect to us on picturesoflily.com, and from there you can choose your preferred podcast platform, or Instagram, or SoundCloud, or YouTube, or Pandora, or Amazon. You can also find the playlist for the podcast episodes on Spotify and YouTube. There is also a Pictures of Lily newsletter that goes out when each podcast episode posts that you can subscribe to on picturesoflily.com. Thanks for listening. Pictures of Lily. We'll be right back.